I'm from Gardasleben, where the Gene Bank of Germany is located, that is storing and preserving plant genetic resources. And as you can see in the title slide, it's in the north of the Harz Mountains, in the middle of Saxony-Anhalt. And we have also two branches in the north for cultivation and preservation of specific crops that are have specific good conditions in the at the Baltic Sea. And around the topics of preservation and research data management, I will speak about in the next 20 to 30 minutes. And I would be happy also to share with you some thoughts afterwards. So that means would be nice if you could have a short discussion because preservation, as you can see here, so let's switch the pointer, is actually shown at the left part of the slide. So that this is the original task of Gene Bank to take care that the seeds in this example are stored in glasses, which is actually the case in IPK. One who has interest can even visit the facility there for preserving. It's a big hall, actually, with controlled environment and conditions. But it's not enough to store the seeds in this controlled environment. So we need also re-multiplication. So that means what the people from the Gene Bank actually do is put the seeds to the field, harvest them, and again put this the harvest into the glasses. And because of this methodology, is not guaranteed that the single variety of a plant is actually located in one glass. So that means that's why we speak about accessions, which means at the end we have different subcultivars potentially in one of this class. But what I want to speak about here in this talk is not about this preservation activity. I want to speak about the right branch of the image, but the research data management unit that I head is doing is actually serving all this research activity that it's using this plant genetic resources and provide data management infrastructure in a broader scale. This means the classical research project at IPK take for instance, seeds from the Gene Bank, but also from collaborative partners, doing sampling in a sense of first growing, of course, the object of interest. In this example, three plants. So that means here we have a cardinality of 1 to x. So that means from one seed, usually the researchers doing which who doing genotyping grow three plants. Then from those plants, there are much more dimensions to be explored because plants have different anatomical structures and have in these structures different processes and functions. Like as you can see here in the plant level or in a whole plant level, abiotic and biotic stress. To molecular processes like transcription activity of in genomes and protein synthesis. So that means we have here a next complexity level. And the final complexity level is because of the instruments that is used to collect and acquire the data that's reached from field observations in greenhouses with specific handhelds or with the use of robots. For instance, this example, it's a hyperspectral camera here mounted. Then we have controlled environments like greenhouses, which also are equipped with automatic devices. So that means roller converters where actually plants are located and where automatically screens with multiple camera setups and also automated watering and so on. At the end, this is the Latest investment in IPK is, as we call it, Finosphere. It's actually a big hall, which is hosting different kind of containers where plants are grown under a simulated natural environment. So with LED arrays, with wind simulation, with temperature simulation, and so on and so forth. So this is the actually the data environment where we tried to bring structure in and to support in the complete data life cycle. So that means at the left side you see some example what we are actually are responsible for. It's our imaging technologies. So that means, as I said before, from fields, plant cultivation, but also from CT imaging, like you see here. So that means it's rape seeds, for instance, where we have different levels of every seed taken, several millions of single data points. And also here we have some light tables where we were actually researchers counting number of seeds, for instance. So this is imaging technology. We have also manually straight scoring. So that means people go in the field and observe the property of interest of the plant. And also genotyping information. So that means sequencing is also in IPK, where we have a sequencing service that provide even pangenome or data for pangenome projects. And what the last information domain is, I want to speak today is about environmental data. So that means we have environmental sensors to measure conditions, not only in greenhouse, but also in the fields to give kind of profiles for the people who want to program the profiles for the Phenosphere, for instance, I presented in a slide before. So the task of the team is to implement research data management aligned to the research data life cycle, so which consists, I think you know this, of this seven phases from planning to reuse. And we make this as possible in a fair, compliant manner. What does it mean? We need to provide different tool sets and services to support all these phases. And in the coming minutes, I will present some of them. And if you are interested in specific topics here, because of the time, I can only touch the different phases very briefly, then we can maybe discuss this afterwards. First phase is processes. So in research data management, processes is important. So that means we have data flows from the instrument to the data publication, to reuse, to validate, to validating and to analysis and so on. And to bring different data domains together, as you can see here. So that means raw image data, image-derived traits, so that means from image analysis software, for instance, environmental data or manually collected data or descriptive data in the sense of metadata. There is it's necessary actually to link the physical objects to a digital counterpart. And for this, we use in a research project called Avatars, digital twin concept. The key message here is, before you actually do a measure, you create a digital counterpart, so digital twin. For this is very important to have in advance a clear identifier system, which consists of a pure digital ID and a human-readable counterpart of this. So digital ID is actually necessary to provide for the gardeners, for instance, scanning possibilities, printing here in this example a QR code. And to supplement this also with a clear human-readable structures. So that means that, for instance, here in this example, we encode the genotype in the first four letters, the field plot. So this is Moosbrook, for instance, the season 2020 to the physical objects. And all these IDs form a hierarchy at the end, a graph. So that we at the end know exactly which measurement comes originally from which actually seed, in this example, rape seed. So this is the concept of digital twinning we use in the Avatars project. Then we have from a large collaboration project in the EU to activate for 19 European gene banks, like IPK is one. We have also in Czech Republic or Bulgaria, France, and so on, other gene banks. And the aim was here to find ways and processes to harmonize the data collection. And for this, in this project, we were able to define kind of best practices and methods, for instance, to score, you see it here, an example, Blumeria infection, which is actually a fungi, and we have ordinal scale, so that means infection rate translated to a scoring system. So 70% of the leaf infected means score of 9, and all this is actually entered manually into Excel sheets, and this was the minimal common tooling, because especially in the eastern part of Europe, the gene banks are not that very well equipped with information technology, but everybody have Excel sheet possibility, and this is actually also a input format where we can validate, because we have clear definition of this templating system. Next example is how we build a harmonized data format. Also here, the basic idea is we do not make it complicated. So that means we catch the people where they are. It's the daily desk workplace. So here we reuse, most of you, I think, are aware of the ISA principle. So that means investigation, study, essay, which is nothing more as a three-level hierarchy. First is one investigation file, then multiple study files and multiple essay files. Study file describe the study object, actually, and the essay describe what you can actually measure in numbers. And then a supplement for this, if you have complex data which cannot match in a tabular way, we have their so-called derived data files and trait definition files, which is also published here in the links. And this is somehow a standard, which became a standard because MIP, minimal information about phenotypic experiment, is now more or less accepted in Europe. And that's why, in brackets, the ELIX here consortium, which is a good catalysator for us to bring such standards into daily action. Only want to check the time. Okay. Then the level of integrated data collection. So that means if we have this possibility to enter data and format data, we need somehow a machine readable database system for this. And because and I'm now more than 20 years in IPK, I saw a lot of database infrastructures come and go and not maintained anymore and so on. And that's why in IPK there was a decision to buy a commercial system to actually do this, because at the end, total cost of ownership is not that high if we would develop it by our own. So it means we had to study here, and the director's board come to the conclusion to buy such a system. And now the question was, what kind of system we buy? It's actually an integrated system. It consists of a laboratory information management system, an electronic lab notebook, and this combination of this is a so-called RALEMS. It's a product of its company, and this actually provide in general tabular data store, but link out also to a massive amount of binary data, like images, for instance, here from microscopy. And the features is that it's automatically installed, rolled out to every desktop computer IPK. So that means we have floating license accounting here, and everybody can actually use this lab information management system, even in this example, to document in an electronic lab notebook what he or she did. And also it's possible to enter data in a tabular form or even import data and so on and so forth. As I said, tabular organized data in general. Electronic lab notebooks are free text documents, but consists also a possibility to use templating for reoccurred lab work. We can register data files. We can even equip the system with individual graphic user interfaces. If somebody like to have the green button at the left lower corner, you know, he or she will get it. So that means it's actually the philosophy is that we provide a system as the user want to have it. We have individual permissions. We have individual data presentation and views and so on. We also provide then standard workflows. So that means, for instance, for sequencing. So the user can actually enter only basic information of his probe to be sequenced, and the LIMS infrastructure and the infrastructure behind takes care of the data flow. It's automated process implemented. It's integrated with Office software. It's very important that you can drag and drop your Excel table in and so on. We use also for project data management. So that means what is actually the publications that were published for the projects. And so we can actually link for the published paper, for instance, the electronic lab notebooks records. So that means if a reviewer has a specific question, we can go back and answer this question. We have data sharing and export interfaces. So it's a backend is an Oracle database. So if software like to access the data in a machine readable way, we provide a harmonized interface. So that means not this complex internal data structure, but a harmonized data export, which is relying on the ISA schema. We have auditing and archiving. So that means we also manage here S1, S2 plants. So that means gene manipulated organisms in Saxony-Anhalt is important to record this in an electronic way. And for this, you need auditing and archiving. So that means nothing is deleted. And we can also show and track who actually changed or entered data. We have long-term support. Okay. So this is the data collection part. I go on now with the data publication part. Here I brought you two examples, also from Alex here. Within the Alex here framework, bioinformatics and European bioinformatics of research data infrastructure. I don't know the acronym anymore yet, but actually this is kind of catalyzer project where we can get in touch with the decision makers. So that means in this specific case, we work together with Emble EBI to define with them a standard how to submit genotypic data. So this is actually what you see here at the right. So that means we have VCF standard, VCF is variation call file format where you actually transport your genotypic data. And that's why, because we have this, we are able to implement an entire workflow, as I said, in the LIMS from sequencing order until the submission to Emble ENA. This is somehow semi-automatic. So that means that we make sure that all genotypic data that it's actually gathers with IPK instruments are actually published. Next example for publication is a software infrastructure that was developed in IPK. It's called EDAL, Electronic Data Archive Library. It's a software library. So that means the idea is here, bring the software to the data and not provide a data repository. So that means we can actually deploy the software to make sure that big data, that it's not matching to standard repository, like the example I showed before, genotypic data, have also an accepted host. So in this case, in EDAL, we can even provide big phenotypic data sets in a scale of several hundred gigabytes to be downloaded. So that means hyperspectral imaging, drone images, and so on. For this, we have here the EDAL system in place. The compromise is here because we can publish a lot of domain-specific data sets, so with own metadata standards. And here we said we provide at least a Dublin core. So that means every of this 15 core elements must be filled in the lab information management system, for instance. And at the end, then we provide a DOI, which can then be linked in the publication. And this is a screenshot how this field experiment here, right, was actually published in the EDAL system. Other research, part of the research data management lifecycle is the stewardship. So that means to onboard actually the people, the researchers in IPK, how they could use the technology my team provide in their research. And for this, we provide research data management planning. So we have an IPK template. Here you see a screenshot from a project, from a EU project. And there you can specify which kind of data I have and so on. And in the questionnaire, we also provide hints where you could actually publish this at the end. For data stewardship, we provide also standard workflows. This is also a published workflow from sequence management, as I said before. So it means what you saw before in these nice images and this data submission pipeline to Embl EBI. We have also formal workflows for this. And this is also published in Elixir. They call it Fair Cookbook. So that means a kind of recipe, what you have to do if you have a research project that produced genotypic data. And with this, we were able, with this big infrastructure and this tooling and the standards, to provide interfaces for information systems. So that means based on the LIMS, Lab Information Management System, researchers who want to do this can implement their web information management system. And here's an example from the Agent project. As I said before, we have here 20 partners. We have 958,000 data points from historic phenotypic data from the European gene banks. We have map layers, so that means we have view to the experiments. We have genotypic data visualized in a matrix way. So that means on the left you have the material, and here you have actually the variants data chromosome wide. So this is also possible, as what I show here. It's information retrieval. I put this slide in because a little bit of Juliana. She likes search engines and information retrieval. This is an old project, so that means it was published 2015. And here we try actually to combine latest technology, as this was in 2015. So that means we have recombiner system, because of information structure of LIMS, for instance. We also host pseudonyms, for instance, but it was also thesauri. We have the possibility, if the search was actually done, to drill down by faceted search. That means select entries which are of interest, and then by some magic technology, we also link to other related public databases. And at the end, we made also code injection. So that means we track what the user did. So that means to have a kind of feedback that we know, okay, there is somebody interested in this record here, right? So it means, but don't click. But we see that the mouse was actually plenty of seconds rare, and so on. And this actually we did also here in the detail space. So that means if the user click on a detail page, we check, okay, what he checked in the details of the web page. Yeah, this is done some years ago. To give you a brief overview at the end about the complete data infrastructure. So that means in the middle is the Lab Information Management System, the RALIMS, better to say. We have deployment is in a Windows Terminal Server cluster. For binary data, we host a Versity hierarchical storage management system, consists of memory, SSDs, SATA shelves, and tapes. And the left side, we have Oracle Database Infrastructure for hosting tabular data and expose SQL and APIs to serve the information systems, for instance, or to push the data to the public archives. And at the right, we also support, it's necessary to support this. So that means people who don't want to use with the Lab Information Management System have also their proprietary access to the backend storage as well. In summary, so that means IPK try to serve all phases of the research data lifecycle, as I said, but it's depending, of course, of persons. So that means we defined responsibilities. So this group of four actually are the PIs. So it means they are responsible to plan for collecting the data, the technicians, and also the scientists are responsible. Here are the data engineers and the software programmers and so on. And so this is a brief overview of the tooling and a summary what we found in the last 12 years. So LIMS was implemented in 2011 in IPK. That it's important not only to have the total technology, but also active network in the community. Then, of course, necessary to have funding, so that case cause sometimes headache. And you have to be involved actively into standards and services in consortia. You need to provide, of course, also processes, not only tooling. So that means easy to use pipelines for the daily use of for the sciences, and last but not least, you need a proper data stewardship. So that means people actually who you can speak with, which do an onboarding for new scientists, and who has actually every time an open ear to actually give you information where to deposit data, which standard you have to use, and so on. And with this, I like to thank the team, my team, the IT of IPK, the collaborators, and now it's time for questions. Thank you.